this video, we will learn about SARS-CoV-2, the virus responsible for the current COVID-19 pandemic. If you wondered what this pathogen is, how it infects our organism, and how our organism responds to its presence, well, this is the right video for you. SARS-CoV-2 is a beta coronavirus belonging to the coronaviridae family. It is an RNA virus and, more specifically, a single-stranded RNA, or ssRNA virus, with positive polarity. That is to say that its genome can act directly as a messenger RNA, without previous synthesis by an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. It has a diameter of 50 to 200 nanometers and is made up of four basic types of proteins, the E protein, or envelope, and M protein membranes, which form the envelope of the virus, the S protein, spike, which contributes to building up the envelope and is formed by two subunits, S1 and S2, and is also responsible for binding to the host cell. And then the N protein, nucleocapsid, which is associated with the RNA and stabilizes it. The preferred route of entry for the virus is respiratory, with upper airway colonization. But the virus can spread even further down into the lungs. At this level, it binds to the host cell through the interaction between ACE2 enzyme on human cells, which acts as a receptor for the virus, and the region of the S protein called RBD, receptor binding domain. There are six amino acids in this region that are essential for the interaction with the ACE2 enzyme. Biochemical and structural studies have shown that this sequence is highly similar not only to the ACE2 molecule in humans, but also to that of ferrets and cats. Furthermore, the affinity of SARS-CoV-2 for ACE2 is higher than that of SARS-CoV, responsible for the SARS epidemic in 2002-2003. So, the binding between the S protein and the ACE2 enzyme takes place via the S1 subunit, which allows the interaction of the virus surface with the cell surface. However, to enter the cell, there is the need of some cellular proteases, such as TMPRSS2 furans, leading to two cleavages, one at the surface between the S1 and S2 subunit, and one inside the S2. Once in the cell, viral polyproteins are synthesized by the RNA to form the replication transcriptase complex. At this point, the virus synthesizes the RNA through its RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, and structural proteins are formed through the RER and Golgi of the cell. This is followed by assembly that, once completed, allows the new virions to exit the cell and spread the infection. One of the most urgent questions that the scientific community is trying to answer comprehensively concerns the reason of such contagiousness and, at the same time, the ability of the virus to determine severe clinical pictures in a relevant number of cases. This is a fairly innovative feature in the world of respiratory viruses. The common flu, although as contagious as SARS-CoV-2, rarely leads to severe clinical pictures. On the contrary, the SARS virus, although it caused a more severe pneumonia, it was also less contagious. But how can SARS-CoV-2 have both? A partial answer to this question comes from its structure and, in particular, from the zone of passage between the S1 and S2 subunits of the S protein, where we find the polybasic cleavage site and the amino acid residues subjected to O-glycolization, two characteristics absent in SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV. But let's see in detail what this is about. The polybasic cleavage site is a region of the S protein consisting of the sequence of arginine, arginine, alanine, arginine amino acids, RRAR, with the arginines being basic, giving a strong polarity to this site. The polybasic cleavage site is, due to its polarity, easily attacked by various proteases, including furin, allowing the destruction of the virus coating and the release of its content in the cell. The meaning behind the function of this site is still unknown, but it was seen that, by inserting a similar site into hemagglutinin, functionally similar to the S protein of SARS-CoV-2, of low pathogenic influenza viruses, these viruses become more pathogenic. Similarly, the laboratory insertion of the polybasic site on SARS-CoV increases the ability of SARS-CoV to mix with human cells, as well as the chances of a pandemic-scale contagion. Now, let's take a look at the second factor, namely the O glycolization of some residues. On the top of the polybasic cleavage site, there is, in the sequence of amino acids, a residue of proline, an amino acid with a particular structure that creates a fold in the overall structure of the protein. As some said, proline-induced folding is responsible for a second unique feature of SARS-CoV-2. That is to say, the addition of certain sugar chains, glycans, to the oxygen of three S protein residues, two serine and one threonine. Many viruses use the glycolization of some of their amino acids to mask the parts of proteins, epitopes, that can generate an immune response. Therefore, although we can't be sure at the moment, these residues of SARS-CoV-2 may create a mucin-like domain on the S protein to mask it from the immune system and allow the virus to freely spread in the body for some time. These observations corroborate the hypothesis of a low activation of the immune system in response to the virus. In fact, it's been demonstrated that coronaviruses can produce interferon inhibitors, important molecules involved in the antiviral response. But then, how can patients with severe SARS-CoV-2 infection have such an acute inflammation and high immune system activation that the use of monoclonal antibodies against IL-6, one of the most important pro-inflammatory cytokines, may have a positive effect on the patient's prognosis? Unfortunately, the pathogenic mechanisms specific to SARS-CoV-2 are still unclear. But by looking at the pathogenesis of SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV, something important can be learned. A few years ago, a comprehensive scientific review on this matter was published. The paper shows that the three COVs, highly pathogenic coronaviruses, differ from the low pathogenic coronaviruses, which instead are really common among the population but can only cause a simple seasonal cold. In particular, SARS-CoV infection undergoes three stages. An initial phase where viruses replicate massively in cells and the first flu-like symptoms are present. Then, an intermediate phase, where fever gets higher in hypoxemia, since the lungs don't exchange oxygen well with atmospheric air anymore, and pneumonia-like symptoms begin to appear. Then, there's a third phase, an advanced phase where the patient progressively experiences respiratory failure and, in the worst cases, death. This third phase has something particular. Although it is the most serious phase, it is also the one with the lowest viral load. This highlights a key aspect of the pathogenesis of SARS, and probably also of COVID-19. It is an infectious disease that, at some point in its natural history, becomes an immune dysregulation disease that determines the most severe clinical pictures. But how do you get to this dysregulation? Let's try to go over what happens from an immune point of view after viruses enter the body. So, we said that viruses can hide, at least partially, from the immune system, and this allows them to replicate in cells quickly without being eliminated. However, from an immune point of view, this behavior leads to a massive increase in viruses that, like all microbiological pathogens, have molecular patterns, BAMPs, capable of stimulating innate immunity. As a result, when the viral load is such that it is no longer able to escape the immune system, it will have to face many stimuli and will respond with a storm of inflammatory mediators, which is why the disease worsens. Aligned with this, studies on patients with SARS and MERS have shown that infected patients with more severe clinical pictures and higher risk of death had higher blood levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines, IFN gamma, IL-1, IL-6, and lower levels of IL-10, one of the main anti-inflammatory cytokines, and this when compared to patients with a milder picture. When studying the behavior of the immune cells responsible for the production of these cytokines, dendritic cells and macrophages, as well as the infected respiratory epithelium cells themselves, it was seen that the production of cytokines was delayed and excessive. Let's close the circle with one last point. What is the effect of this inflammatory storm on the body? This massive presence activates cytokines of apoptosis pathways in both epithelial and endothelial cells of the lung, with alteration of the vascular lung texture and formation of edema in the tissue. Macrophages are the main elements of immune responses, capable of orchestrating all other cells. They are actors who can play many different parts depending on the occasion. If exposed, as in this case, to high levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines, they activate as M1 macrophages and support and amplify the inflammatory response. However, due to the excessive and prolonged inflammatory stimulation on macrophages, M2 polarization activate and bring about fibrosis, consequent thickening of the pulmonary interstitium, and difficult respiratory exchanges. The third effect on the body is the development of ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is the leading cause of death in these patients. In conclusion, there is much evidence to suggest that the pathogenesis of SARS-CoV-2 is similar to that of SARS-CoV. Therefore, therapeutic approaches addressing these mechanisms may be effective in the future.